Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure for me to have a conversation today with the Oliver Schnyder Trio, with two members of that trio. We have Oliver Schnyder himself and also Benjamin Nyffenegger, or Ollie and Benny for short. So welcome virtually to the University of Hong Kong.
Thank you, Daniel.
Hello.
Hi. Now, it's a great pity that you're not able to come here and give your concert, which I was really looking forward to, you know. But we are going to make sure that you will come, and next year we'll reschedule the program. But before we continue with our conversation, maybe you can just introduce the program that you would have played were you here right now in Hong Kong. It seemed to me a great program to celebrate Beethoven's 250th birthday this year.
Well, thank you. It's Beethoven's anniversary, as everybody knows, and we're sorry for the great Ludwig that his anniversary year kind of falls into the corona abyss. We would have played an early trio. It's called the Gassenhauer, a trio which is originally composed for clarinet, cello, and piano. And it can also be played by the classic piano trio. That's a milestone of his early period. And then two milestones of Beethoven's second period, the Ghost and the Archduke trios. So it's like the three named trios we would have played. And we would have loved to come, and we're very sad we cannot be there in October, but we will definitely be there next year.
And it's great to allows. Yeah, it's great to celebrate Beethoven this year. It's such a pity that we can't do it properly.
Yeah.
But actually,
but you know, it's Beethoven anniversary is you pick any year. It's always Beethoven anniversary. So
true.
It's going to be
that is so true. What do you think was Beethoven's own contribution to this genre of the piano trio? Because I think he played a very significant role in that.
I think for us, it's really the way he handles the instruments individually, which makes these trios such a major step in the piano trio repertoire. When you look at the Haydn trios, that actually, you know, brought the trios as an ensemble really into the main repertoire. The instruments were handled, of course, with a very soloistic piano, as we always have, a kind of soloistic violin and a more bassline cello. And Beethoven really really started to set the trio up as three individually strong and also lyric instruments, which makes it so exciting for a trio to play. And unbelievably difficult. I remember the time when we started to, I'm sure you remember, when we started to play the Beethoven trios, the first couple rehearsals were only there to actually get our head around the kind of sound you need to produce, and in a very difficult instrumental position always, because he has this awkward quality of writing very uncomfortable things for the strings, I'm sure also for the piano, which actually originally do not sound well. And just to get over these
obstacles,
we needed quite a bit. But it's a deep connection one has to build to this composer, because you have to get through so many problems to be able to perform it then.
Your program is wonderful in that it, you know, it has this early piece, the Opus 11, that reminds us that the trio was actually a very popular genre. I mean, it was a very sort of amateur thing that people would play at home. And this was, you know, the final movement is a variation based on a very, very popular tune that people would be singing in the taverns and in the streets. And then you move on to like the big named trios, right? The Ghost and the Archduke. And that really is a substantial statement. I mean, do you want to say something about those two trios and what kind of statement Beethoven is trying to make now in this genre that seemed to be such a kind of amateur popular genre before?
Well, by the time he composed his two opus 70 trios, he was in a state of experiment, and especially in the first trio, the Ghost Trio, he went to heights that have never been reached before, especially in the second movement, which gave it its name, Ghost. It was, I think, Czerny, who was reminded by, you know, the first appearance of the ghost in Hamlet. That's why it has its name. It is really sort of atmospheric music. It's music that lifts out of silence. It plays with silence and sounds, and it doesn't even go into thematic material. So that's a completely new concept of composing that he establishes there, and it's really, I mean, also it was the fourth and the fifth piano concertos were composed at the time. I think the seventh symphony was composed at the time. He really, as a freelance musician, he really decided that he has to go beyond what was done before, and he reached new heights and a new, completely new level, which is still a great miracle. And it's an adventure. It's always an adventure. We have played the pieces and recorded the pieces a couple of years ago, and still when we're trying to keep them fresh and find new borders and go beyond those borders, it's a great challenge. And it's probably along with the Schubert trios, also with the Brahms, but it's such a privilege to go that close and to feel the original idea that led to these great masterworks.
I mean, with these pieces, I mean, what is the most challenging aspects of playing, you know, say the Ghost or the Archduke Trio? I mean, you already mentioned that, you know, the writing is already somehow a little bit awkward in the way that everything sits. But apart from that, I mean, what is the main challenge here of these pieces for you when you rehearse them and then try to interpret them and get them across to an audience?
I think, as you mentioned, really one of the first big obstacles is to find the right sound. To find this, there is a very thin line of playing, very crispy and clear, but also you need to have a lyric quality. And if you lose any of those both poles in your playing, you either lose one of the string players against the piano, or you give the impression of only completely harsh playing. So you actually always need to have an incredible control about your articulation and sound. This goes for string players. It speaks for itself that a pianist is all the time, of course, you know, that's all he does is controlling
move his fingers
and controlling every bit, every move he makes. the second big obstacle, in especially in the ghost, is intonation, because you have these very long lines of absolute, almost in the same register between violin and cello, unisono lines, especially in the slow movement. It is such a struggle to find the right intonation, not only that it is in tune, but that it also speaks the intonation speaks in terms of what is the characteristic of that movement especially in the slow movement, where it starts really from, it's such a haunted sound, it comes from nowhere, and it's like it's in the somewhere in the back. And to actually reproduce that, you have to play with intonation, you have to play with the mixture between the instruments, so a bit more cello, not too much violin, because if the violin starts to stick out, the impression of wrong intonation comes up. It's a very strange thing between string players, that you actually need to find the right balance. And then also you start, and the piano comes in with kind of it's quite a stretched high up chord. No, and we play a low register for 3-4 notes, and then the piano comes in with this high pitch note, and to actually find the right intonation also for the piano that comes in later, it is so demanding, and that goes on for the whole movement. Beethoven, really, we talked about this many times. It's interesting. It's a bit similar with Shostakovich. You have this vertical. You have to be so together vertically, because it is written that way. There's a lot of chord changes, a lot of short notes that actually have to lie perfectly above each other, and on the same time you have this big lyric qualities that come, and it is so demanding, but it's such a joy actually when you're in sync, and you feel that yeah, we found our way to handle Beethoven. It is really something that's it has a very special magic, I would say.
And if you think that music is a horizontal activity, it's an art of time, and you go from point A to point Z, and you have these, it's just punctuated by these vertical events, and especially in Beethoven, those vertical events, they have to be informed by a pulse that is shared by the three of us. And in order to find this pulse and the subdivision of long notes, you have to hear the subdivision of long notes, you have to hear between the vertical events, yeah. You know what I mean? And that is something that takes a lot of time to achieve.
Also, there is no margin for error, somehow it feels like. Obviously, one always goes for the highest level, whatever composer it must be. But I would, now I might cross the line here, but I would say that if you play a Brahms trio, there is a bigger margin of what sounds together and what doesn't sound together, because you have these broad,
it can be more
sounds.
Rhapsodic.
You can, yeah, and you can really lay into the sound, and you can speak a bit later, but it sounds full and rich and nice and da da da. With Beethoven, if you're not together, everyone in the concert hall is going to go like this, because you hear everything instantly, and we are aware of that. That, you know, that actually is quite a bit to handle for your mind,
nerves.
For your nerves, because you're aware of these things. But it's also such a great joy when you know that you have two colleagues that and you can trust them, and it works, and yeah, it's fun and scary. ¶¶
Because in classical chamber music, I mean, you know, you have the quartet and you have the trio. So the, basically the piano trio and the string quartets are the two main sort of units. In many ways, the trio are often seen as the sort of poorer cousin for some reason, right, to quartets. But actually, they're very, very different from the quartets. I'm very interested in how trios work. I mean, what is the kind of relationship between players? What is different about the trio compared to the quartets? And also the repertory as well. To me, it's a very different type of repertory that you're representing. So can you say a little bit about that?
Well, Benny is a member of a string quartet as well, the Julia Fischer Quartet. He can elaborate on that. For me, in the trio, a basic thing is that as a pianist, I have the feeling of playing duo, as the strings are really one, and I'm lucky enough to have Benny and Andy. Who are, you know, we're all I names, Ollie, Benny, and Andy.
That's nice.
I have the luxury that I don't play with two people, but with a like solid string block. And I never have to retain myself as a pianist. With other chamber music partners, I always have to put a stress on not playing too strong and loud, and with them I can do anything. I can play like a piano concerto with a big orchestra. They are so so strong and so rich in sound that sometimes I have to ask them to be a little kind.
Yeah, that's one of the big obstacles in piano trio is the balance. A piano, a dynamic, a written piano in a string quartet has a different meaning when you talk about how to play a piano instrumentally than it is in a piano trio. In a piano trio, you need a constant focus in your sound, otherwise you're lost. And what about the dynamics within the group? It is, in our case, it's like this, that we are three incredibly different personalities. We have this very calm and, I always say, the conductor mind, Andreas, our violinist, who has this, is naturally given view of the structure of the piece, of the big picture, basically. And then we have Oliver, of course, who has such a vast repertoire, also of course as a soloist in the piano trio, that brings always great quality in special musical moments, context with other pieces, you know.
And Benny's role, he's sort of our alpha animal, and he's the one to lay his finger in the wound. You know, he really talks about things that don't work. Andy and I were more like generous and think, well, next time it's gonna be better. But Benny is really keeping us together and keeping us focused. We all have our specific roles, yeah. and it works well. And we're, as you said, we're completely different personalities, but we're also great friends. And we see each other not only at the instrument, we see each other for beer and party as well.
Oh, that sounds really nice.
Football is always
and a football,
big, soccer.
Soccer.
Well, Shostakovich actually is a great soccer fan. Did you know that? I know you've been playing COVID.
That's right.
He was mad about soccer. But I look forward to meeting and hearing the trio then next year, especially to hear the metaphysics that your wonderful group will produce. Of course, it's a time of lockdown. So I'm just wondering what you've been doing, you know, during this time, because obviously a lot of concerts have been cancelled. And so what does a trio do, especially one as close-knit as you, as the Oliver Schnyder Trio? I mean, what do you do in this time? When so much has been shut down?
Well, obviously we couldn't perform. And all our concerts were gone. We did some little concerts now, like with less than 200 people in the audience. But we decided to go to the studio and we recorded some repertoire that we wanted to record eventually, but we did it now. And we recorded pieces that were suitable for this state of crisis in a way.
The first recording we did with it was a Dvorak Dumki trio and Smetana trios, and a couple weeks later we recorded both Shostakovich trios, and just last weekend we recorded the Shostakovich quintet with our friends Julia Fischer and Niels Menkemeyer. And yeah, for now I think for this year we are done probably with recording, but it's something we were able to do at a certain point. I mean, the first 2 months of lockdown, and lockdown in Switzerland was never as extreme as it was, let's say, in Italy or in Spain. We were always able to go outside and do stuff, but we were not able to meet. We were not supposed to meet, so we couldn't rehearse. We couldn't play chamber music. And that for myself, the first couple of weeks, I didn't turn myself to the instrument because I was just, there was just somehow no point, and it was also a time that I needed to relax, and I think it went like that for a lot of people. But I remember when we started talking about maybe doing something with this time that was somehow also given to us by this crisis. There was after first obstacle to overcome this it was really something very special to actually just come back with the trio, rehearse, work. It was really special. It was a good thing. And that was actually the only thing after May that was constantly somehow around now, musically speaking, was the trio.
I mean, the programming, I mean, the recording that you made of the Smetana and the Shostakovich and the Dumki, the Dvorak, I mean, definitely these are very dark works. I mean, you said that they were kind of coronavirus-inspired choices. I mean, the Smetana I know about, you know, is about his young daughter dying of an infectious disease. And obviously the Dvorak, I mean, Dumki itself is a kind of bohemian lament. I mean, it's a very sad, rhapsodic kind of piece. Shostakovich, I don't know at all, but I guess that's also one of these sad pieces, is it? I mean, is it like the whole thing is sad?
Yeah, it's full of lamento, absolutely. but you know, it's... Actually, we had the desire to really produce deep and deeply felt music, but it was also the music that we had in the repertoire and that we could play. We were scheduled to record the Mendelssohn trios, and we were very methodical so far. In the last 10 years, we recorded all the Schubert, all the Beethoven, all the Brahms trios, and Mendelssohn would have been next. So we had to postpone that because our recording producer was stuck in New York. So Smetana and Dumki, those were pieces that we had played many times in 10 years, and those pieces were just ready to go. And they were a perfect match to the overall situation, absolutely. But it wasn't that we picked them because of the situation, because they were sad and tragic pieces. That's just an accident.
Well, there seems to be a lot of tragic trios out there, you know, that you can play. I mean, in a way, and we talked about this a bit earlier, I mean, composers tend to use trios, right, as for major events, major statements. Is that something that... Yeah. You feel to be the case?
Well, I think the composers felt that they could say the most, like chamber music wise. They have in a piano trio, they almost have an orchestra. They can do as many colors as a symphony orchestra can do. But still, it's a small group, and it's inviting for experiment. And I think that's the reason why they didn't want to write a full-fledged symphony. They wanted to experiment first, and the trio is just the best choice for that, the piano trio. If you think of Schubert and Tchaikovsky and Rachmaninoff, Dumky, Dvorak, those were really probably the most suitable means to express something that was expressed in a most natural way in the piano trio.
It might well be. I find it hard to say, but I agree that but I would say similar things speak for the string quartet about how much meaning a piece can inherit or is given by a composer. But obviously it's true that the piano trio has incredible possibilities. Also, a lot of these composers were pianists, no? I imagine that, but writing for your own instrument as well, you know, and giving yourself two partners can be something very fulfilling and something very, very personal, which, you know, when Beethoven wrote the string quartet, of course they are amazing pieces, but he would not play them himself, right?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think the Archduke was Beethoven's last performance, actually. As the pianist, Ollie, you would be Beethoven, and the cellist was Linke, and then the violinist was Schopenhauer, and that was the last. That was Beethoven's last performance, because people said he didn't play so well on the piano, although the music was great.
Here anymore? Yes.
But it also means, actually, with composers at the piano, I mean, Mendelssohn would be the same, right? And so on, that and composers making these very big personal statements in the trio, that you have some of the most amazing repertory in the classical canon. I mean, you know, it's just amazing music that trios can play. So I look forward very much to your performance next year of the Beethoven trios, but also I hope of all these other amazing trios out there that we should really hear. And I'm sure that you're wonderful interpreters of these great works. So thank you so much, Ollie, and thank you so much, Benny, for taking your time. I know you're very busy. You have other things on. And it's great to see you outdoors in your garden as well. I really envy you. It looks really quite tropical out there. So maybe you're actually in Hong Kong. And
right.
You're not really very far at all.
You're very soon in Hong Kong.
Yeah, we want you to be here very soon. So thank you very much. It's been a pleasure talking to you. And thank you for your insights.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye.